Let us stand together as we open our service. And that's not the right majesty. But it's okay. Hymn 215 in your hymnals. But I bet most of you really know this one very well anyway. So let us stand together and let us sing Majesty as one.
Majesty, worship His majesty.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Baptist Church this morning. Just a reminder of deacon ordination today at 3:00 in the merge. Also, the grand can opening will happen this Saturday, March the 28th, from 9 until 12 behind Sports Convenience Store. Any questions or for any donations that you may have, if you would contact Sherry Still, she can tell you all about that project. Also, the Secret Keeper Crazy Hair Girl Tour will be taking place on April the 17th at First Baptist Church in North Augusta. Now, I love all of my girls, but I cannot take them all by myself. This is a mother and daughter event, and if you are interested in attending, we will have a church bus that will leave the church and go together as a group. If we have enough people who are interested, tickets are $18. And we have to have 10 or more people to sign up to be able to get that discounted rate. If you are interested, please see me or contact the church office no later than April 1st so we can make those arrangements. Also, we will be having an Easter extravaganza on the Saturday before Easter from 3:30 until 5 here on the church lawn. That will be for all of our children who are a part of the children's ministry. It's going to just be a great day of fun for the children and the families with an egg hunt and face painting and things of that nature. If you would, and if you would like to make a donation to that, we have baskets that are available in the foyer area and on the first floor for candy-filled Easter eggs, as well as snacks like chips and things of that nature. So those donation baskets are available. Thank you so much. Pastor Keith.
Good morning. Wonderful to see all of you this morning. And we're going to pray, but before we do, I want to remind you, I haven't said much this year about our Tenebrae service. Wednesday, April 1, 10 days from now, we're observing a Tenebrae service, and some of you, that's a new terminology to you, so let me tell you what that is. We have Palm Sunday, and then the next week, we observe the Lord's resurrection, but something very important happened in between those times, that Jesus rode into Jerusalem victorious as the King of Israel, and that time when Jesus rose up from the grave. Something that is very important to our salvation occurred, and that is the suffering and the passion of Christ. And Tenebrae is a service where we commemorate the Lord's death and His betrayal, and in fact, That was the occasion when he was having the Last Supper with his disciples. And so we will observe communion together at the Tenebrae service. So I hope you'll come out. Those who have come to that in the past have really been blessed by that service. I am blessed by that service. And so I hope you'll come and be blessed by that service as well. Wednesday, April 1st, 6 o'clock at the Merge. Let's look to the Lord now and let's pray together. Father, your word tells us that you call forth from the waters and you renew the earth in the falling rain. And we look at the skies today and it amazes us. Lord, we can't suspend so much as a single drop of water in midair, but you can move millions of gallons of water and transport it from where you want, from where it is to where you want it to be. And then you use the process of doing that to renew the earth, and we see the flowers blooming and the trees budding and leafing, and there's something in us that just bows at your majesty because of the way you do things just like that. So Lord, while it is overcast outside in our hearts, there is sunshine in our souls today. So thank you, Father, for gathering us here. And I pray that as we worship you, that you will be exalted and that we will be encouraged and uplifted, that we will learn from your word today, that we will strengthen one another today, that we will sing your praises today with all of our hearts, that we will love you more deeply when we leave here than ever before, and that we will be closer to you, that you will draw close to us. Lord, we come to a time when we want to bless your holy name, and we ask that you would honor us for doing that. We want to honor you, and so please honor the desire of our hearts to give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us join together as we sing, He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Thought. I did not copy the second page of this one. So if you'll turn in your hymns to 238.
Let's look to the Lord now and let's pray. Father, you are good. You are good in your nature. You are good in your person. And all your works are good. Everything you have ever done, you have been able to look at and say, it is good. And you are good to us. You have been so kind, so benevolent to us, so generous to us. You have given us your Son, and having freely given us your Son, what good thing would you withhold from us? So, Lord, now it is our time to give back to you. And I pray that you would help us to be mindful of how generous you have been to us, mindful of the fact that you have called us to be at work in your vineyard, and that this is an opportunity when we can advance your kingdom by our giving. So help us, Father, to give with generous and grateful hearts so that we may advance the name of Christ in this world and glorify you and do the work you've called us to do. We love you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for calling us into your family. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Michael, thank you very much. Beautiful. And Justin, wow. Who can name that instrument that he's playing? I just learned this. He had to tell me. Anybody else know what that thing is? It's a box, and he sits on it and beats it like a drum. Called a cajon. C-A-J-O-N, a cajon. How about that? And you played it great, man. Yeah. Let me invite your attention to the book of Revelation, chapter 3. We're going to continue our series, Visions of the King. And today we're in Revelation chapter 3, where we encounter the letter to Sardis. This is the portion of the book of Revelation where Jesus is writing several letters to the seven churches that are in Asia Minor. Those seven churches, there are more than that, but those seven churches are representative of all of the churches that are in Asia Minor, and indeed of all of the churches in all times, at all places. And I think as we have gone through this series, we're now on the fifth church. And I think with all of the churches we have discussed so far, we've been able to see ourselves in those churches. And so the same will be true today with this letter to Sardis. Now, I would remind you that there are seven common elements to each of these letters, an address in which the Lord, who is dictating the letters, dictates them to the angel or messenger of a particular church. And then he focuses on his authorship, and he goes back into Revelation chapter 1, where he is revealed as the Son of Man who went before the Ancient of Days and received all of this glory. The picture that is painted of Jesus is the most beautiful, stunning, majestic picture you could ever imagine. And he goes in and picks out one aspect of that particular revelation of himself. And remember, this is the revelation of Jesus Christ. And he says, these are the words of him who, and he will focus on one attribute or aspect of that revelation that is always pertinent to the particular church to which he is addressing himself. Then he gives them an element of awareness. He says, I know. Usually it is, I know your works. But sometimes it is, I know your circumstance. I know where you live. I know what you're going through. I know what you're dealing with. I know you. Then he'll give them an assessment. Strengths. Weaknesses. And along with those strengths and weaknesses, he will give them an alert. Usually it is in the form of shoring up the weaknesses, those things that he wants corrected. And if they do not correct them, there will be consequences for failure to do so. If you do not repent, if you do not do what I'm telling you to do, I will do this. And then he's not just negative. There's always the positive as well. He will give an assurance. But if you will do these things, to him who overcomes, I will, and then he gives these beautiful, majestic, glorious promises. And then always an admonition. Let him who has ears to hear what the Spirit of God is saying to the churches. So let us today hear what the Spirit of God is saying to the church at Sardis. Let us hear what the Spirit of God is saying to First Baptist Church in Barnwell, South Carolina. Revelation chapter 3, beginning with verse 1, to the messenger of the church in Sardis. Write, he who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars says, I know your deeds. You have a name that lives, but you are dead. Be watchful and strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have not found your deeds complete before my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Obey it and repent. If you do not watch, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few names in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes, and they will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out his name from the book of life, but will confess his name before my Father and the angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Let us look to the Lord now and pray. Father, this is your word, and your word is truth, and it is profitable for us. And so I pray that we would take it deeply into our hearts, that we would be attentive today, that we would give you this hour, that we would not be concerned with the things of the world, what happened yesterday, what is in front of us tomorrow. I pray that instead our focus would be on you. You've taught us to love you with all of our whole heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, and with all of our strength. So may we, in this moment, give you our minds and open up ourselves to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we've been talking about these seven churches, there is sort of a circle that is created, and we started with Ephesus, and then we've just sort of been going clockwise, and we're now to the fifth church, the church that is at Sardis. To understand Sardis, and really to understand this letter to the church at Sardis, we need to understand some of the background, and really it's helpful to go back 650 years before this letter was written. I think the letter to the church at the letter of the book of Revelation was written somewhere around 95 AD. So you're going to have to back up to about 550 years before Christ came. Back before there was the Roman Empire, there was a kingdom that existed in this part of Turkey that was called the Kingdom of Lydia. Sardis was the capital city of the Kingdom of Lydia, and I'll tell you why they made it the capital city, because it was a fortress city. Sardis is up on a mountaintop. To access it, you have to climb a steep hill. And the actual city itself, which is set on this mountain, is virtually unattainable. It can't be assailed. It cannot be conquered. Because on three sides, on the north, on the west, and on the east, it has a precipice, a giant cliff that is 1,500 feet. Virtually straight up. And on the south side is the only possible access, and it is a very narrow mountain passage that is easily defended. You'd have to be crazy to bring an army into that narrow passage, because you're just sitting ducks if the people of Sardis are in their citadel, in their fortress. And so back 550 years... before Christ, they had a king there by the name of Croesus. Now, how many of you have ever heard the saying, rich as Croesus? Anybody? There are a few of you. It's not a saying that we use much anymore, but that was the magnitude of wealth of this city. In fact, the first city to actually mint coinage. 650 years before Christ, Croesus was stamping out gold coins. And Croesus was this powerful, rich king of Lydia, and Sardis was his capital and his fortress city. He became so powerful, so wealthy, that he determined he could go against the Persian Empire, which was led by a king named Cyrus. Now, you know Cyrus. Cyrus is a biblical king. We can recognize that name from the book of Daniel and from other biblical books as well. So you know how strong the Persian Empire is. You may have never heard of Croesus, but you've certainly heard of Cyrus, and you've certainly heard of Persia, even if you'd never heard of Lydia before. Well, Croesus was so rich, so powerful, that he became arrogant, and he thought, you know what? I'm going to take the fight to Cyrus. And so he marched out with his army to engage Cyrus in battle and to invade Persia, and got whipped, came running back with his tail tucked between his legs, and got back to his capital city. Well, by this time, of course, Cyrus is in pursuit. But nobody's worried, because Sardis is unassailable. Except that it wasn't. Cyrus had one man a single, solitary mountain climber who did indeed scale the unscalable wall of Sardis. And while the army is poised there to protect the southern pass, that narrow passage that leads into the city, one solitary mountain climber ascends to Sardis and opens the gate from the inside and allows the army to come in. And the impossible happens. Sardis fell. In fact, there was a saying back in the day that was as tough as taking Sardis. And that meant accomplishing something that was virtually impossible, but it happened. Sardis, because of its arrogance and because of its lethargy, because of its failure to just pay attention to what was going on, Sardis fell. 400 years passed. And Sardis fell into the same kind of state. You know, it's easy to forget something that happened 400 years ago. It's easy to stray from those things. Our country is less than 300 years old. Think about where we were in the 1700s as a nation and where we are now and how far we have strayed from our founding principles as a nation and as a society. Well, the same thing had happened in Sardis. Yes, Croesus had fallen and Cyrus had taken Sardis, but that was 400 years ago. And guess what? Exact same thing happens again. And do you know how it happened? Do you know how Sardis fell the second time? It fell exactly the same way, through their inattention, through their failure to just simply be watchful. Because they presumed in their arrogance and in their pride that no one could scale the wall and take Sardis. And so knowing those things helps us make sense out of what Jesus is writing to the church in Sardis. Because the church in Sardis had taken on too much of the culture of the city. The church in Sardis was sleepy and lethargic. Oh yes, Sardis had been a magnificent city back when Croesus was the king, and it was rich and powerful. And there was still some old money hanging around Sardis the way there's still old money hanging around Charleston. But the truth is, they were just basking in their former glory. And so was the church. It was a peaceful church. It did nothing to disrupt anyone. Other churches in Asia Minor are under severe persecution. Some are under persecution from the Jewish population that doesn't want to disturb the Romans. Some are under persecution from the Romans. Not Sardis. Sardis hasn't done anything to disturb anyone in forever. A peaceful church. One of the commentators says, neither the Jews nor the Gentiles seem greatly to have been troubled by the people of Sardis. Sardis was a very peaceful church. It enjoyed peace, but it was the peace of the cemetery. It was a church that was basking in the former glow of its glory days. A church that was now completely oblivious to what was going on around it, and delusional in the belief that it could never fall. I've known churches like that. When I was in Pennsylvania, there was a town up there called Oil City, and it was called Oil City because there was lots of oil up there. In fact, you may not know, but the first oil derrick that was ever installed in the United States was installed in Titusville, Pennsylvania. And there was lots of old money up there. And First Baptist Church of Oil City was this magnificent church with a magnificent sanctuary. I'm talking about the edifice here. Beautiful, beautiful building. Would seat easily 700 people. And they were cramming 25 or 30 people in there every Sunday morning. And then I had a friend. There was another church that didn't even have its own building. And they were just booming. And they were so busy for the Lord. And they were doing things like we try to do here. They were having a soup kitchen that fed the poor. And they were having people that went into the schools and worked with children. And they were trying to influence their entire community. And this little church that didn't even have its own building was just burning it up. And so my friend was called to be the student pastor. And he was going to a church there, and someone who knew that he was going to a church there asked him this question: are you going to the church that has everything and does nothing, or are you going to the church that does everything and has nothing? Which church called you to be their youth pastor? There are churches all over Europe, these magnificent cathedrals, and you look at them, and the structure is beautiful, and the architecture is awe-inspiring, and just to be in the building, it's just a wonderful thing. But the gospel hasn't been declared in that building for hundreds of years. Jesus says to the church at Sardis, that's how you are. And then Jesus then talks to them about who it is that's writing this letter. And he says, these are the words of the one who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. He holds the sevenfold spirit of God in his hand, and he holds the seven stars, these seven churches. I want you to think about what that means. Christ has in his hands both this needy church and his life-giving spirit. He and he alone can bring together those two, the life-giving spirit of God to this church that needs life, to a church that not only needs to be diagnosed, but to be revived from the dead. And so Jesus says to them, I know your deeds. I know what you're up to. I know what you're doing. And then Jesus gives them this assessment. Now there's an interesting thing, and I hope you picked up on it as we were reading the scripture. In all of the letters that we've encountered so far, Jesus is almost effusive in his praise of the churches when he says, I know you. I know your works. I know your perseverance. I know how you can't tolerate wicked people. I know that you're doing more than you did even at the first. I know you. And he pours praise upon them and assesses their strengths. And then he says, but I have this against you. And he focuses on one little thing. And I want you to fix this one thing. Just fix this one thing. It's not necessarily a small thing. But he'll pour out his praise and then say, nevertheless, I do have this one thing against you. In the letter to Sardis, it's exactly the opposite. Jesus begins with the weakness. And I think that's saying something. And here's what he says to them. He says, you have a name for being alive, but you're dead. In other words, there is a conflict between their image and the reality. A difference between their perception and what really is. I thought about that this week as I was giving a devotion at another meeting, and I was talking from Psalm 8, and I wanted to talk about the stars and their magnificence, and their vastness and the vastness of the universe. So let me talk to you for just a moment about that. You know how far away our sun is from our planet? It's just roughly 93 million miles. And so light that leaves the sun takes about 8.5 minutes to reach the Earth because it's traveling at 186,000 miles per second. It's driving faster than my wife going to Columbia, right? So 186,000 miles per second and still takes 8.5 minutes to get to the Earth, traveling the distance of 93 million miles. Do you know what the next closest star is to the sun? It's actually a cluster. Tom knows it. I see him telling Jackie. And it's Alpha Centauri, which is actually a cluster of three stars, but it appears to us to be one star from where we are. That's because it is not 93 million miles away, but 26 trillion miles away. And traveling at 186,000 miles per hour, miles per second, excuse me, traveling at 186,000 miles per second, it takes the light of Alpha Centauri 33 years to reach Earth. Now think about that. The difference between 8.5 minutes and 33 years. That's the distance between the sun and Alpha Centauri at 186,000 miles per second. So that's some vastness. But here's what I thought about. You're wondering, what does that have to do with Sardis? Here's what it has to do with Sardis. Since it takes that light 33 years to travel to us, for all we know, Alpha Centauri blew up in a supernova 30 years ago, and we still don't know about it. Because the light that we're seeing from Alpha Centauri didn't just leave Alpha Centauri, it left Alpha Centauri 33 years ago. And if that thing exploded, it's going to be 33 years before we even know about it. Excluding the Hubble telescope, of course. But you see my point. That's the state of Sardis, according to Jesus. You've got this name for brilliance and light. You've got this name, a reputation for being alive. But the reality is, you're just dead. And here is this church at Sardis that's just like that. It had a name, but it was dead. It was shining solely by the light of a magnificent past. The image just didn't match the reality. And do you want to know why? Do you know how those two had gotten out of sync? Because their promise didn't match their commitment either. Jesus said, "I've not found your deeds complete before my God." Now, to understand what is being said there, think about this parable that Jesus told in Matthew chapter 21. He's asking the Pharisees, "What do you think?" He said, "There was a man who had two sons. He went to his first son and he said, 'I want you to go out and work in my vineyard today.' And his son said, 'I will not.' But later, he changed his mind and he went. And then he went to his second son. And he said, 'I want you to go out and work in my vineyard today.' And his son said, 'All right, Dad, I'm going.' And then as soon as his dad left, he went back to playing his video game and never did go out into the vineyard. And Jesus said, 'Now, which of these do you suppose did the will of his father?' And they said, 'Well, obviously the first one.'" There are all kinds of people that don't show a whole lot of promise, but in the end, they get the job done. And then there are people who overpromise and underdeliver. They've got all kinds of potential that they just never quite live up to. That's what Jesus is saying of Sardis. I have not found your works complete in the eyes of my God. In other words, they've got all kinds of potential. There's all kinds of promise. There's just no depth of commitment. There's no follow through. There's no getting it done. That's the church at Sardis. Do you know why? They're arrogant. They think they're unassailable. They think they could never fall. They're basking in their former glory. And they're now oblivious to what is taking place in the world around them. And so Jesus, rather than just giving the full assessment of strengths and weaknesses, having given them this weakness, gives them this alert. Be watchful. Now, actually, there are five imperatives here. Do you know what an imperative is? It's an emphatic command, something you absolutely must do. I wonder if anybody here, I know lots at the 8:30 service, anybody here ever get an email from Mike DeToma? Yeah, we got at least a couple who got emails from Mike DeToma. Mike DeToma apparently does not know where the period is on a keyboard, because Mike DeToma ends every sentence with an exclamation point. And so how, you may wonder, does he really make a point when he's wanting to make something emphatic? Well, he uses multiple exclamation points. These are five imperatives. If Mike DeToma were writing this letter instead of Jesus, every one of these five things that is said here would have 6 or 8 exclamation points after it, okay? Number one is be watchful. Now, how meaningful is that to the church at Sardis, a place that has fallen twice simply because in its presumption they thought they were safe and never bothered to just watch the cliff wall to see if somebody might be climbing up the cliff wall. Jesus says to the church at Sardis, you be watchful. 2, strengthen what remains. He says to them, even what remains is about to die. Paul Simon, I can't remember if he was with Simon and Garfunkel or if it was just Paul Simon at the time, but he sang this song, Nothing But the Dead and Dying Back in My Little Town. And it's sort of that way at the church in Sardis. There's what is dead, and then there's what is almost dead. That's all that's there. But Jesus says it's not too late. Strengthen what remains. Build it up. Shore it up. Protect it. Develop it. Nurture it. Cultivate it. Strengthen what remains. Don't just give up and say it's too far gone. Get busy and strengthen what remains. Then he says, remember. And it's interesting that he says that, because that's one of the things they certainly did. They remembered the glory days. They remembered when they were all rich as Croesus. That was their heritage. That was their culture. But that's not what Jesus is saying to remember. He's not saying remember the good old days, back when Buck was a calf, back where when things were as they should have been. What he says is, you remember what you received and what you heard. Remember the word of God that was proclaimed to you. Remember the word of God that was preached to you. The word of God that was taught to you when you gathered in midweek for your Bible study. Remember what you learned. And then he gives them this imperative, and obey it. It's not enough just to come to church on Sunday morning and hear the word of God proclaimed and leave thinking, well, what a nice sermon. As if anybody ever thought that anyway. It's not enough to just hear the word of God proclaimed. The scripture is very clear. We are called to be doers of the word and not hearers only. Jesus said, don't just collect more notes in your Bible study journal. Start walking in the light that you do have. Obey what you do know. Remember what has been taught to you, what you received, and obey it. Fifth one is just repent. Stop doing what you are doing. Turn around. Go back to that place where you were pleasing, when you were thriving because you lived for me. Go back to that place and start doing those things you did then. So five imperatives, but then with that, he only gives this one single warning. If you do not watch, and how meaningful is that to a church in Sardis of all places? If you do not watch, I will come like a thief. You will not know at what time I will come to you. Now, normally when we think of someone coming like a thief, we think that that means they're coming for some bad purpose. But here's the truth is, the truth is not that he's talking about coming for a bad purpose, but that he's talking about coming unawares. If you know when a thief is coming, it's not you who's going to have a problem with a thief, it's him who's going to have a problem with the Second Amendment, right? Some of you will get that later. And Jesus says, that's how I'll come to you. I'll come when you don't expect it. I'll pay a surprise visit and do a pop quiz. I want you to take care of this. I want you to be responsible and strengthen what remains. I want you to be watchful, but if you don't, I'll show up and I'll take care of this, Jesus says. I'll come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I'll come to you. Now, let me point out, normally when we hear that language in the Bible, coming like a thief in the night, Jesus uses that language on four separate occasions to describe the second coming. And it might be easy for us to think about Jesus referring here to the second coming. But he's not. He's saying to a particular church, if you don't repent, I will come. Now, the second coming is not dependent in one bit, in the least, on whether or not Sardis repents. He's not talking about the second coming. What he's saying is, I personally will come and visit your church in Sardis, and I will deal with you. Then he returns to this strength, the assessment. He says, yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. You know, normally when Jesus is writing these letters, it's you're doing all these things well and keep doing those things, but you're doing this one thing, and I want you to fix it. It's the bulk of the people are doing well, but there's still this one false prophet or one false prophetess or one phony group. In this case, it's exactly the opposite. Jesus says, and it almost sounds like a concession to us, doesn't it? Yet you have a few names in Sardis, a few people who have not soiled their clothes. You know, there's a passage of Scripture that most of us are familiar with, or at least we're familiar with most of the passage. And it's in James, and it says, pure religion, that is undefiled or acceptable before God and our Father, is this. And many of you sitting in the room could finish that verse for me. To visit or to take care of widows and orphans in their distress. But most people stop right there. And that verse does not end right there. This is pure religion, which is undefiled before God and our Father, to take care of widows and orphans in their distress, and to keep oneself unspotted by the world, uncorrupted, unpolluted, uncontaminated by the world. That's what Jesus is saying here. There are just a few. There are a handful of people in all of this magnificent city. There are a handful of people who have kept their garments clean, kept their robes white, and have not been messed up and muddied up by the world. They've not crawled into the mud puddle or the pig pen with the world. All right, so Jesus has been fairly stern with this church at Sardis. But that sternness is matched by his assurance. He who overcomes will, he who deals with these issues, follows the five imperatives, heeds my one warning, he who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white. I want you to notice the passive voice there. They will be dressed in white. Not they will dress themselves. They will be dressed in white. And that's the first promise that he gives. It symbolizes purity and honor and cleanness. And the one who overcomes will have his garments white, even though they're muddy now. Those garments, they will be dressed in white as well. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white like snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be white as wool. Jesus says to the one who overcomes, I will dress him in white, whatever your past may be. Whatever the past may be for you, for the church, for whoever. Jesus says, if you'll just do what I'm asking you to do, I'll dress you in white. And their name will never, I will never blot out his name from the book of life. Now we need to say something about that, because we hear that and it sounds like something to us that it's really not saying at all. It sounds to us like, and many people think, there's this book of life. And one day I professed Jesus as my Lord and Savior, and when I did, he wrote my name down in the book of life. And then if I'm good, he will leave my name in the book of life, but if I'm bad, he may blot my name out of the book of life. In other words, he may have given me salvation, and I may one day lose that salvation. He gave it to me, and one day he may take it away. But that is not at all what Jesus is saying here. You have to remember that this is a Roman world. The Roman world was obsessed with keeping records of people, both for purposes of controlling those people and for purposes of taxing those people. Jesus was born under the circumstance of a census being taken for taxation purposes. When someone was born, his name was written in the record. You know what the record was called? The book of the living, the book of life. So when someone was born, his name is written in the record, just like we do for our census. When someone's being born, they'll do another census in 2020. They'll write those names down. When he died, his name was blotted out. He no longer existed. There's a similar thought among the nobles of Rome. Those kind of people who had risen to a level of greatness where they had their own statues, they had their own busts, they had their own monuments. Their names weren't written in the book of life. Their names were carved in stone, like Caesar Augustus. That census that Caesar Augustus ordered, do you think he was listed in it? He didn't need his name carved. When he died, everybody knew it. He didn't need his name written in a book of life. His name was already carved in stone. But even with the Caesars, even with those great nobles, if they did something, that was infamous, notorious, like Caligula, a succeeding emperor would do everything he could to eradicate the name, chisel the name out of public places. If buildings were dedicated to him or by him, the name was chiseled out. It was carved out. So, Jesus isn't saying that some people have earned their salvation, but they could just as easily, by their bad deeds, lose their salvation. That's not what he's saying here at all. In fact, it's helpful, I think, if you don't even think of a literal book. Think of this as an expression of Jesus. And what he's saying is, the one who overcomes will never die. Like those honorable, worthy people who had white robes, they will be given white robes and they will never lose that honor. Their name will go on for all of eternity. Sardis had a name for being alive when in reality it was dead. There will be people who are thought to be dead when in reality their name goes on forever. Their name will never be blotted out of the book of life. And in fact, they'll be recognized by that name before God and before the millions and millions or billions and billions of angels in heaven. We see this from time to time if we're watching Downton Abbey or if we're watching news coverage of a state dinner given at the White House. There's a butler and someone walks up and they present a card and the butler announces, Mr. and Mrs. Tom Ramsey. And they are acknowledged. And they are welcomed in. What Jesus is saying is that honored person who overcomes, who fights the struggle, who goes through it, and doesn't just yield, that person will have a robe of white, honor, a name that will never be blotted out, a reputation that will never be sullied. Indeed, I will recognize them. I will call their name before my Father and his billions of angels. What a magnificent thing to think. Father, this is my faithful servant. This is Emma Jean Burbage. And I'm happy to present her to you and to all of the angels. Can you imagine what a wonderful thing that is? How gracious is that promise? If you thought the warnings were stern, I want you to think how much more gracious the promises are than the warnings are stern. So now, it's just up to us to apply this. How do we apply this to ourselves? Well, think about us as a church, but really, more so, think about yourself as an individual. How is it in your spiritual life? Do you have a reputation for spirituality? Oh, yes. We live in a Christian nation. Oh, yes. I'm a Christian. I'm not a Buddhist, certainly. I'm not a Muslim. You have a name. In reality, you're dead. A name for being alive when the truth is that's not reality. Or a name of a past, a reputation that goes behind you, but not in front of you. Oh yes, I'm a Christian, but it's been years since I cracked open the Bible, got on my knees and asked for anything other than my own comfort or my own well-being or that of someone that I love. You see, that was the state at Sardis. They just weren't watching. They were just oblivious. They were self-absorbed, self-absorbed, self-content, self-reliant. What about us? What about you? Let's pray. Lord, we love your word, and we love its truth, even when it's not easy truth. Yet it's still, it's good truth. These promises that you hold out for us, if we will remember what we've heard, what we've received, and if we'll obey it and repent, if we'll just be watchful. Lord, thank you so much for your word that is so profitable to us and benefits us. And I pray that if there's anyone here today who has never received the Lord Jesus, that they will know that you are the King of glory and that you are coming again, and you have promised you will come as a thief in the night and told us to be ready for that day. Help that person who has never before been prepared to truly stand before God and to meet the Lord Jesus face to face. I pray that they would make this the day when they make things right with you, confess to you their sins, and turn them over to you and ask for forgiveness, and that they will join that happy multitude who enters the kingdom of God and is given white robes. And Lord, there may be others who are here today and they've just been on cruise control, oblivious to what's going on around them, not really paying particular attention to their spiritual life at all. But I pray that you will help us to see those things and deal with those things honestly and faithfully before you come to us. Lord, we love you. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen. If I can help you in any way, pray with you. If you wish to join the church, if you wish to know the Lord, I'd be happy to show you. You come now as we sing.
Stand together.
Blessed day, everyone.